all I will start from the infections. Herpes simplex virus infection has been asked earlier in exam, right? So we have to remember these are all sexually transmitted disease, right? So herpes is a sexually transmitted disease, and a lesion will be red papule, right? So they are red papular lesion, and their incubation period will be for 3 to 7 days. Approximately 1 week of the incubation period will be there. I'll try to cover as much as possible. Right, so latent virus infection, actually this virus infection is the latent virus, means they will be, you know, they will not be showing symptoms, and for longer time they will be remaining inside the nerve ganglions, right? So usually they will be localized into the lumbosacral nerve ganglions, right? Usually they are in the lumbosacral nerve ganglions, and they will be reactivated. So this is the one special feature of the herpes simplex virus. They will be remain localized for a longer period, they will be dormant, and after some time, when the person is having more stress, trauma, or immunodeficiency, like a diabetes or HIV infection, or some hormonal changes, that will reactivate this infection. So that is the property of the herpes simplex virus. So these are the two things we have to remember. They will be latent for a longer time, where in the ganglions, where in the lumbosacral ganglions, right? And they will be reactivated by stress, trauma, immunodeficiency, and hormonal changes. So how we are going to identify them? Now the question is, see, that is the clinical part, that they will be for 7 days, incubation period will be 7 days, and then there is a red papular lesion. They will be dormant for the, in the lumbosacral ganglions, and they will be activated or reactivated by the immunodeficiency. But the question is how we are going to identify as a pathologist, right? So then we have to see their epithelium. So whenever we are seeing this kind of skin lesion, we are going to see their, cytology or histopathology. Both places will be finding the same finding, right? And that is the Cowdery type A viral intrusions, right? Cowdery type A viral intrusions, which will be present in both cytoplasm and nucleus, right? And remember, in the nucleus, because of this viral intrusion, you will be finding 3M, right? What are the 3M? Margination, multinucleated, and molding of the nuclei, right? Already I have told you molding of the nuclei in the neoplasia, lung neoplasia topic, right? So there is a one nucleus which is putting impression on the another nuclei is called molding, right? So impression of one nucleus on the other nuclei is called as molding of the nuclei, right? Small cell cancer of the lung, very good. So margination of nuclear chromatin, multinucleated, molding of the nuclei along with the Cowdery A intrusions in this squamous epithelium is diagnostic feature of the herpes simplex virus, right? So you can see here, this is the cytology. Similarly, you will be seeing in the in the histopathology also, you will be finding the same thing, right? So you can see there are so many nucleus. All these are nuclei. What I'm making with the red color, all these are nuclei, right? And in this nuclei, you can see their margin is having very deep blue color, thin deep blue color margins are present, right? If you look at this one, right? Can you see this? There is a blue margin. So this is the chromatin margination. This is the chromatin margination. And what we are seeing, purplish in appearance. What you are seeing, purplish in appearance, these are all viral intrusions. These are all viral intrusions. Now you can see that entire cell is multinucleated, margination of the chromatin, right? And they are putting impression on each other, molding of the nuclei. So these are the 3 M we have to remember: multinucleation, margination, molding, right? And that is the herpes simplex virus infection. So remember this pap smear, this is the cytology or pap smear, which examiner can ask you in exam, right? Now next infection is molluscum contagiosum. Molding, I told you, that you only told me that molding is the one nuclei is putting impression on the other nuclei is called as molding of the nuclei. You can see there are so many nuclei putting impression on the other one. Here only that. You can see here, you can see there is one nucleus like this, there is another nucleus like this, right? Like this. Here. Fine. So now you can see another is molluscum contagiosum. There is this topic, molluscum contagiosum, you will be always seeing in your exam. I'm seeing it from past 4 years. Continuously they're asking either in the AIMS exam or PGI exam. And nearly all AIMS exam they're asking this topic. Sometimes in dermatology, the treatment, sometimes they'll be asking histopathology. But something is always asked from here, such a good topic it is. Right. So molluscum contagiosum, when we talk about molluscum contagiosum, what we remember? They are because of the pox virus. Right? They are due to the pox virus. There are two types of the pox virus, type 1 and type 2. Type 2 is associated with sexually transmitted disease. So we are talking about female genital tract. So it is type 2, which is associated with the sexually transmitted disease. So usually they will be affecting the skin and the mucosa aspect, right? So skin and mucosa. So skin and mucosa will be affected. Incubation period will be for 6 weeks. So approximately 1.5 months. We can say that approximately 1.5 months will be the incubation period. Or 45 days, you can say that, right? On average, 45 days will be the incubation period for molluscum contagiosum, right? How will be the gross appearance? When you are going to see molluscum contagiosum, if you are going to see the gross picture of the clinical examination, you can say that will be pearly papular lesion, right? Pearly papular lesion, which is dome shaped, and this dome shape will be having central dimpling. So because of the necrosis. So see, this is the lesion, right? I'm showing you this is the lesion, and this is the central part which is showing you dimpling or invagination, right? Or there is an invagination, dimpling or umbilication, you say that. So why there is a dimpling or umbilication? This dimpling or umbilication is due to necrosis. So centrally there is a necrosis, right? So central part there is a necrosis, and because of this necrosis there is a dimpling, right? So that is how you are going to see on the clinical examination, right? So now you can see dome shape, pearly papular lesion, dome shape, pearly papular lesion with central dimpling or umbilication. So remember, central dimpling or umbilication is the necrosis. Because this virus is affecting and the concentration is more in the central part of the lesion, right? And these viruses and their toxins are causing damage of the skin or the epithelium in that area, and because of the necrosis they will be having invagination, and they will be showing you dimpling in the central part, right? So this will be looking like this, right? So when you are going to take a microscopic examination, so you can see that when I'm cutting the skin through and through, right? So this is the side view you are going to appreciate. Can you see this epithelium should have been like this, but because of the necrosis in this area there is a central dimpling. So you can see central dimpling is there, and what you are going to notice in the epithelium, you are going to notice numerous intrusions, and these intrusions are round to oval, eosinophilic in appearance, eosinophilic ellipsoid bodies. These are called as eosinophilic ellipsoid bodies. What is the name of these viral intrusions or ellipsoid bodies? Henderson-Peterson body. Right? So Henderson-Peterson bodies are present in the molluscum contagiosum. Right? So if you look at the clinical scenario, now you can see this is how the skin will be looking. So now in this lesion, you can see there is a, if you see it very carefully, can you see that there is a shiny area? Right? Shiny area. So this shiny area is papular lesion, pearly papule. So this is the papule and look shining like a pearl. That is why pearly papular lesion. And this area, you can see this area where I'm marking the, just a minute, give me one time. Look at this one where I'm making arrowhead. So this arrowhead which I'm making is the area where you are seeing the necrosis, and because of this central necrosis there is a dimpling, right? And here you can notice there is a pearly lesion. So this is the pearly papular lesion with central necrosis, and this is the reason for calling them with umbilicated lesion or dome shaped lesion. So umbilicated lesion, right? So that is the gross finding, right? Now when you are going to take the biopsy, now you can see the biopsy is also corresponding in a similar manner. You can see there is a skin, and here you can see there is an invagination. So cup shape biopsy. So why we are seeing this kind of cup shape biopsy? So can you see that in that cup, what has been filled? That is the necrotic tissue. That has been necrotic tissue. So that is corresponding to the clinical picture. Can you see this corresponding to the clinical picture? Central necrotic area. Now you can see here, central necrotic area is here, and because of this, there is a central dimpling, right, like this. So why it is because of the virus they are causing damage. So where will be the virus? They will be coming down, and where they will be located? In the epidermal cells. So now you can see eosinophilic ellipsoid bodies are present in this. These are all molluscum bodies or Henderson Peterson bodies, right? So now you can see all these things. All eosinophilic structure, you can see all the round eosinophilic structure. These are all round eosinophilic elliptical structure. So these round eosinophilic structures are called as ellipsoid body. Eosinophilic ellipsoid body. And these eosinophilic ellipsoid bodies are known as Henderson-Peterson body, right? So that is the name which I was telling you that time, Henderson-Peterson body, right? So Henderson-Peterson bodies are seen in molluscum contagiosum, right? So that is this question was asked earlier in NIMS exam with both gross and both clinical or gross, you can say, and the microscopic, right? Now, this we have read a study also, right? Condyloma acuminata is also known as genital wart, right? STD caused by HPV-6/11, sessile papillary projections, varicose appearance, and microscopic, there is a coelocytic ATPR. So what is coelocytic ATPR? Hyperchromatic large nuclei. Hyperchromatic large nuclei, where in the large cell and perinuclear halo. Remember, perinuclear halo. Yesterday also we have read about this when we were discussing about the penile condyloma acuminata, right? So they are all because of the HPV-6/11. And when you are going to see now, HPV-6/11 also causes papilloma. This is papilloma only. You can see this. There are so many small projections, right? So these are all papilloma only, right? These are all papilloma only. Right, so what the cauliflower like lesion or sessile projections, we can say like this, right? So what the sessile projections or papillomatous lesions are there, right? And when we are going to take the section from here, so same thing we are going to see, right? Same thing, the same SPV 6 and 11 can cause papilloma. The papilloma is called as wartum, right? So either you can see, if you look at these cells which are larger and cytoplasm is clear, so all these are coelocytic change, in the epithelium of the HPV infected cases, right? Now, coming to this topic came 2 or 3 times in NIMS exam, and DNB, FMG, all exam, they had asked this question so many times. First time it came in the FMG 2015, and after that in November NIMS 2015 also the same question was asked, right? They have given the cytopathology or pap smear of the bacterial vaginosis, right? So bacterial vaginosis is also an STD, right? It is a sexually transmitted disease. STD means sexually transmitted disease, caused by which bacterium? Gardnerella vaginalis. This is important, right? So bacterial vaginosis is caused by Gardnerella vaginalis. Here in clinical feature, what you have to remember, vaginal discharge will be there. So patient will be coming with the history of the vaginal discharge, and when you are going to see the examination of the vaginal discharge, it will be thin, greenish or greyish in appearance, and they have fishy smelling appearance, right? So they have been fishy smelling, fishy odor will be there, right? So vaginal discharge is thin, greenish to greyish, and fishy odor, right? On microscopic examination, blue cells are diagnostic of bacterial vaginosis, right? So blue cells are diagnostic of bacterial vaginosis. How we are going to identify blue cells? See, this is the cytology pap smear, right? That is how the examiner will be giving you in exam. Pap smear will be given to you in exam. What are these things? These are all squamous cells. So now you can see squamous cell borders are quite clearly visible. These are normal squamous cells, right? And you can see the borders are clearly visible. Here also you can see this is the normal squamous cell borders are clearly visible. Here you can see some of the basophilic dot-like structures are there. So these basophilic dot-like structures are hiding the squamous cell lining, right? So what are these basophilic siblings? These basophilic stipplings are actually the bacterial colonies. So that time you have to remember that basophilic stippling, which is covering the epithelium and hiding the edges of squamous epithelial cell. So basophilic stippling is covering the epithelium and hiding the edges of squamous epithelial, which you can see under normal condition. Right. So this is the clue. This is the clue that this is the affected by bacterial vaginosis. So this is not seen in other conditions, right? So this is the diagnostic finding, two cells. That is why it is called as clue. It is giving clue about the bacterial vaginosis, right? So this is how we are going to identify bacterial vaginosis. Now you can see there are some cells. You can see here, if you look at this squamous cell, this is the clear-cut squamous cell. But you look at this one or this one, can you see? You cannot appreciate their sharp edges. Why sharp edges are not visible? Because of this bacterial colony. So what are these things? These are all bacterial colonies, right? So basophilic stippling is bacterial colonies, right? So remember, basophilic stippling, all these are bacterial colonies, which is covering the entire epithelium and hiding the edges of squamous epithelial cell. So that is why this kind of cells are called as clue cells, right? And this clue cell will be diagnostic of bacterial vaginosis, right? Clue cell is diagnostic of bacterial vaginosis caused by which bacterium? Gardnerella vaginalis, right? So that is how examiner will ask question from here, right? So clue cells are what? These are the bacterial colonies covering the squamous cell and hiding their edges, and they're diagnostic of the bacterial vaginosis or Gardnerella vaginalis, right? Now coming to the next one is again a very important MCQ. Examiner can ask you, and I have seen it is very difficult. I'll tell you, the day examiner is going to ask you this question in your exam, this will be not an easy question, even though I'm going to show you the picture, even though you are going to understand now, but it is very difficult to appreciate during exam time, but does not mean that it is impossible and you commit mistake, right? Why I'm saying, because majority of the students are going to commit mistake because they do not know how to identify Trichomonas vaginalis, right? Just remember, it is again a sexually transmitted disease, and this is again a very important MCQ. I think this INICD also there was a question, if Trichomonas patient is coming, what is the treatment? Because in this patient, actually what happens, once you will learn, finally, don't worry, it is not a second year thing, but I'm just telling you in advance, when you are going to see the female patient with Trichomonas vaginalis, suppose the diagnosis is done, Trichomonas vaginalis female patient, so what is the next step? Next step is to ask the partner means her husband, right? Her husband you have to call, because this is transmitted from one to another, right? So you have to treat both of them, then only this will be cured. Now you understand this point? So this was a similar question. I don't remember exactly what was the question, but the similar question had been asked in this INICT exam. This is seen, and you have to treat both the partners which are the following infection, and it can be. So now you have to understand, this is the flagellated protozoans, right? Flagellated protozoan, which is sexually transmitted disease from the female to male, and that is why, or from male to female, whatever. So that is why treatment of both the partners are done simultaneously. Remember, simultaneously, not like first you will treat the female and then you will treat the male. Now then what will happen? Then they will be getting transmission from each other, right? Alternatively, so sexually transmitted disease by a flagellated protozoan, they will be having flagella. But remember, flagella will be seen only in the smear, not in the cytology. Cytology is very difficult to appreciate the flagella. So usually patient is asymptomatic or fruity vaginal discharge. So that is another big thing which we will notice in suspicion. They'll be having no symptom or occasional fruity vaginal discharge will be there. And cytology will confirm the diagnosis. Cytology means pap smear. Here, I want to tell you one thing. When you are going to see the pap smear, you have to remember two things. Okay? You have to remember two things. Please remember my words. Just remember these two things. Done. You need not to mark up any other thing. Just remember two things. What is the spear shape organism? So, can you see the spear shape organism? And how is the nucleus elongated? Basically, that's all. Don't look for the flagella. Will not be visible, right? So, even though it is flagellated, but it will be very difficult to appreciate, right? And it's highly impossible, I can say, you on the cytologic scale, right? So, you can see this is the picture. That is a similar picture I have seen that I have asked in the MB exam. And now you can see, out of these cells, what is this? This is the normal squamous cell, right? Normal squamous cell. And here you can see all these are some inflammatory cells, right? But if you notice these two cells, can you see this? None of them, they are showing flagella, right? That is why I said don't look for the flagella. And what you are noticing, they are pear-shaped. Can you see this? They are pear-shaped. And now the nucleus is elongated. Nucleus is elongated, right? So this is the trichomona. So that is how you are going to identify pear-shaped organism with elongated nuclei. Pear-shaped organism with elongated nuclei. So these are the two important facts to give the diagnosis of the trichomonas vaginalis, right? So can you see this pear-shaped organism, elongated nuclei, that will confirm the trichomonas vaginalis. Do not try to look for the flagella. Means don't decide that you will see flagella, then only I will be correcting it. So that will be a mistake, right? Fine. Now coming to the actinomyces. So this question came three times, 2015 November, 2016 June, 2016 November, right? Two times it came as a histopathology and one time it came as a cytopathology, right? Same picture will be seen in the both cytopathology and histopathology. So what is characteristic of the actinomyces? Actinomyces is again associated with intrauterine device, like copperty, right? So the patient will be coming, who is taking care for the, trying to control the family, or doing the family planning with the copperty. So because of the copperty or any intrauterine device, I'm not saying only copperty, any intrauterine device, IUD means intrauterine device. Those who are in secondary, I think they'll be having difficulty. Intrauterine device, right? So that is the full form of IUD, intrauterine device. Cytology is cell. Histology is cell, the relation with this all surrounding structures. Right. Cytology will be seeing like this only. I'll show you that. What you are seeing here, can you see this? What you are seeing? It is only cell. No blood vessel, no surrounding tissue. So this is the cytology. And pap smear is the cytology only. Pap smear is example of cytology only, right? So if you want to know that, whether there is any difference between these two things, no. So pap smear is the cytology only, right? Fine. So here we are talking about the IUD will be there and they will be presenting with the pelvic pain and vaginal discharge. So they will be having pelvic pain or vaginal discharge. When we are going to see the actinomyces, they are gram positive infection, and how we are going to identify their cotton ball like structure and sun ray like radiating filaments will be there. So now you can see cotton ball like structures and they will be having sun ray like radiating filaments. So this is the actinomyces. And this is not only on the, not only on the cytology, this will be seen on the histopathology also, and this will be seen on the cytology also. So both places you are going to see the same thing, right? So how is the actinomyces? First history will be very ideal. Intrauterine device will be there, pelvic vein and the vaginal discharge will be there, and actinomyces will be like a cotton ball and sun ray like radiating filaments. So now you can see this was the exact picture which I've been asking in AIMS exam. This is the histopathological examination. In this histopathological examination, first of all, you should know that what I am marking with the yellow color. Can you tell me, anybody, what is this yellow color I'm showing you? Can you tell me what is this? All small. Very good. These are all inflammatory cell, neutrophilic inflammation, and this is called as abscess or micro abscess. May not be seen by the gross examination. If it is seen only on the microscopy, then they are called as micro abscess consisting of the neutrophil. And in this micro abscess, you can see these are brightly eosinophilic areas. These brightly eosinophilic areas are the areas of necrosis. Necrosis, right? So this eosinophilic area, which I'm showing you from here to here and to here, is the necrosis, right? Now look at the edges. Can you see the edges? They are very dark in appearance and they are radiating like a sun ray, right? So they are dark ray sun radiating filament. So sun ray like radiating filament. No, it's if you look at the if you look at the cells now, if you're looking at the lymphocyte, they will be like a round blue cell like this. But when you're going to see the neutrophil will be having fragmented cell like this, like irregular cells like this, it will be seen, right? Fragmented or irregular, but they will be having blue round structure like this. So this will be the lymphocytes and this will be the neutrophil on the peripheral on the histopathological examination. That is how we will identify. It is difficult for you, but for me, it's not difficult because we are much habitual of all these things, right? So there is a necrosis and sun ray like radiating filaments, right? So sun ray like radiating filaments along with neutrophilic inflammation, that will be the actinomyces. That will be the feature of actinomyces, right? This is the histopathological examination, right? Now I'm showing you the actinomyces on the pap smear. So this is the pap smear, right? This is the pap smear or cytological examination. Here you can see these are all normal squamous cells, right? Now look at this one. Can you see? This is the cotton ball, and now you can see there are radiating filaments. Can you see? All these are radiating filaments, cotton ball with radiating filament, right? So what is this? This is the cotton ball. And these are the radiating filaments. See, what I wanted to tell you, this entire structure is looking very blue in appearance. So it is not only blue in appearance, they can be eosinophilic also. So it can be eosinophilic or basophilic, anything, right? It depends on the mixture of the staining. So I am saying, because if you are seeing the similar structure in the eosophilia, then also eosinophilic appearance, then also it is actinomyces only, right? So that is why I said remember two things only: cotton ball plus sun ray like radiating filament, that's all. It is the actinomycosis. Whether it is a eosinophilic or basophilic does not matter, right? Now the next one is the chlamydia. Chlamydia, I have a strong doubt that they will be definitely a future question, because it's a very characteristic picture of the cytology, and I don't know why examiner had not asked till now. So my doubt is definitely they're going to ask this question in upcoming exam. So it's again a sexually transmitted disease by chlamydia, and we all know that this is the most common cause of non-gonococcal urethritis. Non-gonococcal urethritis, and vaginal discharge will be there. And how will be the appearance of the cell? So that time you will be seeing they are having glassy intrusions. So this is the squamous epithelium cell, and they will be having glassy intrusions within the squamous cells, right? So they will be having glassy intrusions within the squamous cells. That will be the feature of the chlamydia. So now you can see this is the chlamydia, right? This is the chlamydia. Now you can see the normal squamous cell, and now you can see this one and this one. What we are noticing, there are glassy intrusions. So all these are glassy intrusions, right? So these are glassy intrusions. So whenever you find glassy intrusions, right, so they are suggestive of the chlamydia, right? So glassy intrusions are suggestive of the chlamydia infections, right? Fine. So now you understood all these infections. Now coming to the a very important benign tumor that is called as sarcoma Bartter's. Right? This tumor is very important, and you will be definitely getting some questions from here because I have seen again this is again a very high yielding topic. Many questions have been asked earlier. So basically, it is a skeletal muscle tumor. Right? Skeletal muscle tumor in origin. What is this? These are the variant of the embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma. Right? So we all know that it is the embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma of vagina. In less than 5 year old female baby, right? So that is the thing you have to remember. Embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma of the vagina, which will be present in less than 5 year old of you know female, and age group will be less than 5 year. Variant of embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma. What is the characteristic? Why this is called as sarcoma Bartter's? Why not embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma? So the twist is the name Bartteroids. What do you mean by Bartteroids? Bartteroids means cluster of grape-like tumor mass. Right. So when we are seeing the tumor cluster of grape, so remember cluster of grape-like tumor mass is coming out from the 5 year old vagina, 5 year old female vagina. Then you can think about the Bartteroids. Right. And that is why it is called as sarcoma Bartter's because of the cross feature. Because of the cross feature looking like a cluster of grape. Right. And when you are going to see the microscopic examination, you are going to see the tumor rhabdomyosarcoma. Right, so rhabdomyoblasts are the tumor cells. Right, rhabdomyoblast is the tumor cell of the rhabdomyosarcoma. How will be the appearance? Tennis racket cell. You remember, tennis racket appearance was Langerhans cell, histiocytosis. And what is this? Tennis racket cell. So please be careful. Tennis racket cell, and they're also called as tadpole cell. Tadpoles are, I don't know many, how many of you have seen, right? If you have been into the villages, because my childhood was in village, so we have seen so many tadpole. And that time there was no mobile, so we'll be playing with these people only, right? So tadpole will be like this only, right? So tadpole will be like this only. So that is why it is called as tadpole cell. Why it is so? It's a cytoplasm, and there is a cytoplasmic protrusion. So this tadpole cell is because of cytoplasmic protrusions. Right, so cytoplasmic protrusions in the rhabdomyoblast are the reason for name called tadpole cell, right? Or looks like a tennis racket, so that is why it is also called as tennis racket appearance or tadpole cell, right? Microscopy, when you are going to see the epithelium or epidermis and dermis, right? Epidermis will be clear, right? Dermis will be having hypercellular. Dermis will be having hypercellular, and all these cells which I'm showing you, these are the tumor cells, right? So hypercellular and these cells are not able to, you know, you cannot see very clearly, they are poorly differentiated tumor cells. So hypercellular, poorly differentiated tumor cells just below the epidermis, right? Just below the epidermis form the cambium layer. This was the question in 2016. Cambium layers are seen in embryonic rhabdomyosarcoma or rhabdomyosarcoma Bartter's, right? Fine. So sarcoma Bartter's will be having cambium layer, which is the hypercellular poorly differentiated tumor cells, which we are going to see in the epidermis, right? In the dermis, right? So these are the dermal tumor cell infiltration, and the epidermal cells are not affected by the tumor. So there is a poorly differentiated hypercellular area in the dermis is called as cambium layer, which is seen in rhabdomyosarcoma, sarcoma Bartter's. So now you can see these are the tumor mass, right? So that is why it is called as cluster of grape-like. So that is why it is called as Bartteroids, right? That is why it is called as Bartter's, cluster of grape-like. That is the sarcoma Bartter's. They're part of their rhabdomyosarcoma, embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma. I've written here, embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma is also known as sarcoma Bartter's. You can call them rhabdomyosarcoma Bartter's. Nobody's going to kill us, right? We can call them also. Fine. So these are the sarcoma Bartter's, and these are the Bartter's cluster of grape-like appearance of the cross appearance. You can see there are tumor mass, which is looking like a cluster of grape, reddish in appearance. So this is the sarcoma Bartter's or embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma. When we are going to see the biopsy, you can see this is the epidermis, and this is the dermis. Dermis and epidermis. In epidermis, now you can notice there are tumor cells. You can see these are the dense tumor cells, right? So this area is dense tumor cell. So this area is called as cambium layer. Cambium layer, right? So cambium layer is a characteristic of sarcoma Bartter's or embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma. Now coming to the endometrium. Endometrium, there are two kinds of inflammation. We have to remember acute endometritis and chronic endometritis, right? Acute endometritis is usually after the abortion, when we conduct abortion, or you know, some people they conduct by themselves also, right? So there are some fools, so they also get these disorders, right? So in the, you know, in villages and all, they don't notice. Still now it is happening, right? Even don't tell, I should not say the villages. Some of my educated friends also sometimes they ask me, can we identify female baby or male baby with this slide? They were telling me, means they were hinting me for the bar bodies, right? So like that, fools are there. Then I told, yeah, we can identify. Please come to my home. Don't tell anyone. I will just call 100 number and then it will be done. Right? So please remember these things. These people are still there. Right? So that time, what happens? This is the problem which female will suffer, not their family. Right? So that particular female is going to suffer a lot. First, you are going to kill her baby. Right? None of the female in this world will, you know, like to kill her baby at any moment. Right? So that is a very bad thing which is happening in our society, and people are doing because of the money and all. Right? So that is not a good thing. So please remember all these things. These kind of patients are more prone for the acute endometritis. Right? So acute endometritis, bacterial infection after the miscarriages or abortion, and it is acute. So obviously, you are going to see the neutrophilic inflammation. Right? I'll just tell you, when I was working in a very big hospital, I'll not take the name. One of my technicians was telling me, sir, I want to know whether my baby is female or male, because she was having two female daughters. Right? Then I said, you are also born from the daughter only. Right? She was also somebody's daughter. Then why you are hesitating from doing that? Haryana and all this, very common where I'm residing now, right? So they want son, they think their son will become Olympic champion, and daughter will not bring. That is why that movie was made. So please remember, all these things are very common things, and it's quite abundant, right? People who are very educated, you know, having so much of money also, they do like this. So that is more frustrating, right? If you do not have money, that also, then also it is not a good thing. But having so much of money and you thinking so cheap, right? So that's not a good thing. Fine. Chronic endometritis is secondary to the PID, intrauterine device, and disseminated TB. So remember these three causes. All the PID is pelvic inflammatory disease. Those who are in final year, they might be doing. When you go to final year, you remember, right? PID is, it's a very vague symptomatology that is called as pelvic inflammatory disease. Right, so pelvic inflammatory disease is the PID. Right, there are so many causes of the PID, and that TB will be also included. So PID, intrauterine device, disseminated TB, because of this, there is a chronic inflammation, chronic endometritis. But here you have to remember that, what will be diagnostic of the chronic endometritis? This is important MCQ. This was the question in the NEET 2016. Right, which of the following cell infiltration in the endometrium is diagnostic of the chronic endometritis? So remember, once you find the plasma cells, right, plasma cell infiltration, right, that is diagnostic of the endometritis, right? So see why I said all these things to you, because we also become radiologists, right? And then we will be going for, you know, some village posting, or in our hometown also, you will be practicing. People from the influential area, they are going to put pressure on your head that you tell me whether it is a female baby or male baby, right? So that time you should know that these things are not very good things, right? Not only this is the inflammation, I'm not talking about with the respect of the inflammation. It creates a lot of trauma to that mother who is, you know, she's expecting so much. And we should understand all these things, right? These are the emotions which count a lot. If you take dowry from the female, how you are going to get respect from the female? you tell me that family will always think he has taken money from my father because he's hard earned. If he's giving you by his wish, then that is okay. But you should not beg now. Don't become a beggar. I'm a doctor. I will be taking so much money from this family, right? That is not right thing. Still going on in this society. Still going on very rampantly in this society. People target these bigger exams, IAS, doctor, engineer, so that they can get a good dowry and they can settle down. You will never settle down by taking others' money, right? So that is one thing. Because they never settle down. They will beg each and every lane, right? So that is how it is going to happen, right? Green curtain. Okay. Is it still disconnecting? Okay. No. Fine. I think I'm touching. That is why it might be. Fine. Maybe the internet connection will be poor. Right. So coming to the endometriosis, another important topic. Here, endometriosis, endometrial tissue, means endometrial stroma plus gland, spindle cell plus gland, will come outside the uterus. Means they will be outside the uterus. Usually endometriosis present in the uterus, right? Uterine cavity. When they are coming out of the uterine cavity, outside the uterus, they are called as endometriosis, right? Endometriosis, most common site is the ovary. Right? Most common site is the ovary because they are coming outside. So they can be present in any organ, lung, liver, right? Or kidney, anywhere. But the most common site is the ovary. No, Anacademy has given me this. Not sure you're going to put like that. Fine. Right side. Fine. So most common site is ovary. Fine. So what is the most common hypothesis is the retrograde menstruation through the fallopian tube. Right. So retrograde menstruation means it is going back and they are coming through the fallopian tube, and that is the basic, you know, hypothesis which has been accepted, most widely accepted hypothesis. In the future, if you are going to see this patient will be young, dysmenorrhea means difficulty in the, you know, menses, and this will be having painful also, right? So dysmenorrhea, pelvic pain because of the all these things, and infertility, right? So these are the important things. Dysmenorrhea, pelvic pain, infertility is the important feature. These are all non-specific findings, right? They're not a specific one. They are for endometriosis, right? What is the risk of endometriosis? See, endometrial tissue. When you are going to see the endometrial tissue, I'll just show you. When you are going to see the endometrial tissue and the normal tissue, what is the difference? Many people, they think that both are common because it's the endometrial tissue going outside, they're not the cancer tissue, so it's a normal thing. It's not like that. There is a difference between the endometrium and the normal tissue. Right? There is a difference between endometrium and the normal tissue. How is the endometrial tissue? Right? What is the difference? In endometrial tissue, you are going to see more inflammation. There will be having inflammation. Whereas in normal tissue, there will be no inflammation. That's all. Because of inflammation, there will be prostaglandin synthesis. PG is the prostaglandin. Prostaglandin, right? So this is the PG, prostaglandin synthesis, right? Prostaglandin synthesis. So because of inflammation, there will be prostaglandin synthesis. This prostaglandin synthesis will increase the aromatase activity. Because of aromatase activity, they are going to convert and form more amount of estrogen. That is the catch point here. So can you see this? What I said, in endometrial tissue, inflammation, prostaglandin, aromatase, and estrogen. So endometrial tissue will be having more source of estrogen. And because of more source of the estrogen, what is going to happen? All these things will be absent here, right? Because of no inflammation, rest of the other finding which I'm showing you here will be absent in case of normal tissue, right? And because of the estrogenic hyperstimulation, there will be increased endometrial hyperplasia, right? So endometrial hyperplasia will be under the influence of increased estrogen, and this endometrial hyperplasia is the reason for endometrial adenocarcinoma also. So now you understood why endometriosis is a risk for endometrial carcinoma. Now you understood, because endometrial tissue in endometriosis will be more estrogen because of the inflammation and aromatase activity. Now understood. So there is more estrogen, and that will be causing endometrial hyperplasia and leading to the adenocarcinoma. Right. Coming to the another important thing, when we are talking about ovarian endometriosis is also known as chocolate cyst. So that is again a very important MCQ which examiner is asked. Yeah, it is pathological hyperplasia. Yeah, this is pathological hyperplasia. We can say that this is the pathological hyperplasia. Right. So ovarian endometriosis is also called as chocolate cyst. So please remember, ovarian endometriosis is also known as chocolate cyst. Right. So these are also known as chocolate cyst. Why it is called as chocolate cyst? Because of the cyclical bleeding within the ovarian tissue. So suppose if you are going to see the ovarian tissue, right, and they are having bleeding, right, because of the recurrent bleeding. So what will happen? This bleeding, RBC will be coming. RBC will be getting damaged, and hemosiderin will be getting deposited. Right. So hemosiderin will be getting deposited. So hemosiderin will be present within the macrophage of the ovarian cyst. Right. So what I'm showing you, this is the ovarian tissue, and hemorrhage, macrophage containing hemosiderin is the reason for chocolate color. Right. The reason for chocolate color. So they may have chocolate color fluid also. So on gross examination, chocolate color fluid, and on microscopic examination, you are going to see macrophage which is having hemosiderin. So what will be the color? Brown macrophages. So you are going to see brown macrophages in these things. Right. So I understood. So what is chocolate cyst? Examiner asks you. What is chocolate cyst? Chocolate cyst is a ovarian endometriosis. Right. What is the reason for the chocolate cyst or ovarian endometriosis? Repeated bleeding into the ovarian cyst. Because of repeated bleeding, hemosiderin will be formed. Hemosiderin will be taken up by the macrophages, and this will be giving you a chocolate color appearance on the cross examination. And a microscopic examination, brown macrophages which is filled with the hemosiderin will be seen on the microscopic examination. So now you can see here. This is the chocolate cyst. Examiner can ask you this question. Identify this beautiful picture, right? So now you can see there are so much of chocolate color fluid because of the repeated bleeding. So this is the chocolate cyst of the ovary. Right, so this is the chocolate cyst of the ovary, or chocolate cyst is also called as. Please remember this name. Sometimes examiner in the Viva, they will be asking what is another name of ovarian endometriosis. Right, ovarian endometriosis. Why there is a recurrent bleeding? Sometimes examiner they ask this kind of question. Always remember, whenever there is a more estrogen, right, this estrogen will be creating more vascularity and vascular fragility. Right, so vascularity and vascular fragility is associated with the increased amount of estrogen. That is why we are seeing all these chocolate cysts, right? So that is why there is a chocolate cyst, because of the increased amount of estrogen hormone, right? Just now we have seen there is a more aromatase activity, right? So that is why there is a ovarian endometriosis or chocolate cyst, right? So microscopy, now you can anticipate what we are going to see. Can you see? They are full of macrophages. Can you see all these brown macrophages? All these brown macrophages are the cystic macrophages with the hemosiderin, right? So all these are macrophages with brown hemosiderin, with brown color. Hemosiderin. You remember first chapter when we were discussing lipofuscin, brown color, two pigments, lipofuscin, hemosiderin, right? Like that we have discussed. So here you can see that so much of brown colored macrophages are there, and these are the chocolate cysts. Once again, the microscopic examination, right? Now this is again a very important. See, endometriosis, adenomyosis. These are the two things you will remember my words in your final year posting. Also, when you are going to attend examiner, these are the pet questions, right? In ops and gynae, your examiner will be asking this question. Tell me what is the difference between adenomyosis, what is endometriosis, and in your pathology also in YY and all, they will be asking how adenomyosis differs from the endometriosis, doctor, right? So now you understood how it differs. Here, endometrial tissue and glands are there. Same thing. There also endometrial tissue and gland, but what is the difference? there in endometriosis, it was away from the endometrium. Now, in that case, when you're seeing such kind of chocolate cysts, you need not to have differentiation because lipofuscin is not going to give you this appearance. If you see this kind of gross specimen and you're seeing this kind of microscopy, then we do not do this because it's specialist in a costly thing, right? So we always try to save the cost in our hospital, right? So if the things are done, then why you have to go for the another stain, right? So endometrial tissue and glands are within the myometrium. See this, within the myometrium, not endometrium. Adenomyosis is what? Endometrial tissue. Endometrial tissue means gland and stroma, both things, right? So endometrial tissue and glands are present in the myometrium, not in the endometrium. Usually they are, normally they are in the endometrium, but they are coming within the myometrium. So they will also come in with the problem of the painful and irregular menses. So painful and irregular menstrual cycle will be their common presentation. Microscopic examination. Endometrial tissue will be 2 to 3 millimeter. Remember, 2 to 3 millimeter away from the basal layer. That is the very important question. It is not given in many of the textbooks, but when you are going to attend the postings, your examiner is definitely going to ask how much distance it should be present from the endometrium, right? So it should be 2 to 3 millimeter away from the basal layer. I will show you in the biopsy also. So endometrial tissue is 2 to 3 millimeter away from the basal layer of the endometrium. For example, I'll just show you. Suppose this is the cut section of the uterus. I'm showing you, right? Cut section of the uterus like this, and this one is the endometrium, right? This one is the endometrium, right? So this is the endometrium. So, and this is the myometrium. So if you find endometrial tissues, just I'm giving you an idea here, then it will not be considered as the adenomyosis. So for adenomyosis to say that this is the basal layer, the outermost layer is the basal layer. So that gland should not be present here. Gland, endometrial tissue or gland should be present minimum 2.5 millimeter, 2 to 3 millimeter distance. So this distance should be 2 to 3 millimeters. Now understood. So this is the basal layer, this is the basal layer, and from basal layer, endometrial gland, these are the endometrial gland and tissue, should be minimum 2 to 3 millimeters away from the basal layer to say that adenomyosis, right? See this. I have made one diagram here. And here, this area is the endometrium. This area is the endometrium, this line. This line is the basal line of the endometrium, right? And now we are seeing adenomyosis. Adenomyosis means we are seeing the endometrial glands and the stroma within myometrium. So that is called adenomyosis, right? Now look at this picture. A very good diagram here, you can understand. See this. Now you can see cut section of the uterus. Uterine cavity is here. Triangular uterine cavity. Then you can see there is a very thin line which is called endometrium, right? And then you can see there is a thick line which is called myometrium. That's all, right? And now you look at this one, the corresponding area into this cut section of the uterus. This area of the uterus is looking normal, but this area of the uterus can be swollen. Why? Because of the grayish white mass. So this grayish white mass is the adenomyosis, which is probably in the myometrium. So now you can see the endometrium is this much. Endometrium is well compressed. This is the endometrial tissue in the myometrium. You can see the entire myometrium has been covered by this mass. So this is the adenomyosis. And when you are going to see on the microscopic view, now you can see this is the entire myometrium. This is the all myometrium. So in myometrium, you should see only the muscles. But what we are seeing, you are seeing the glands. Can you see lumen and the cells are surrounding? So these are all endometrial glands and stroma, right? Endometrial glands and stroma are present within the myometrium. So that is the adenomyosis. Clear? And this distance must be 2 to 3 millimeter away from the basal layer of the endometrium, right? That is the criteria we must remember. Adenomyosis, you should remember, it should be always 2 to 3 millimeter away from the basal layer of endometrium. Then you will say, otherwise if it is less than 1 to 2 millimeter, then it is not considered as the adenomyosis. That is the normal finding of the endometrium. Clear? Now coming to the endometrial tumor, right? Endometrial tumor, there are two important endometrial tumors: malignant mixed mammalian tumor and endometrial adenocarcinoma. Malignant mixed Müllerian tumor. Why it is called as mixed Müllerian tumor? Because they are also known as carcinosarcoma. Why it is called as mixed Müllerian tumor? Because they will be having carcinomatous feature also, sarcomatous feature also. So what are the carcinoma feature? Carcinoma feature will be gland, epithelial gland. Sarcoma feature will be spindle cell. So now understood. Carcinoma like epithelial cell glands and sarcoma like spindle cell. That is why it is called as carcinosarcoma. Examiner will be asking you a very simple question. A uterus biopsy was showing you abnormal tumor forming glands along with the spindle cells which are forming the tumor, which are the tumor cell component. So tumor cell component is showing glands and spindle cell both on the uterine biopsy. Most likely diagnosis is malignant mixed Müllerian tumor or carcinosarcoma. Usually patient will be the older patient postmenopausal and they may have history of the radiation exposure. Right? So postmenopausal radiation exposure, and this will be the malignant mixed Müllerian tumor. They will be having glandular pattern, they will be having spindle cell pattern. Both will be present, so it means carcinosarcoma. So it's a mixture. That is why mixed Müllerian tumor. Yeah, when you become a gynae surgeon, that will be very important in surgery. Gynecological surgeries. Not the proper surgery, you will not be getting this because gynecologist, they will remove it. Either gynecologist or maybe the oncosurgeons when you will become super specialist. Endometrial adenocarcinoma. Now, endometrial adenocarcinoma, there are two types, right? And remember, endometrial adenocarcinoma and mixed Müllerian tumor both are older patients, right? 55 to 70 years like that, the age group will be there. Here, it is very important to know that type 1 and type 2 endometrial adenocarcinoma. These are the two types of the endometrial adenocarcinoma which examiner is going to ask you. Type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is associated with obesity, increased estrogen, and associated with hyperplasia. You remember when we were discussing in first chapter atrophy and hyperplasia, that time I told you that hyperplasia is associated with endometrial adenocarcinoma and atrophy is also associated with the adenocarcinoma. Hyperplasia is associated with type 1 and atrophy is associated with type 2. These are the questions in the GMAT and NEET PG exam. So hyperplasia is type 1. So obesity, estrogen, hyperplasia, right? So because of the estrogen, there is hyperplasia, right? Type 2, no estrogen, no obesity, thin, and they are having atrophy, right? So atrophy of the endometrium, and hyperplasia of the endometrium, most commonly associated with P10 gene mutation. So this point is also very important, and that was also NEET PG question, right? Endometrial adenocarcinoma, most common mutation is the P10 gene mutation, right? And type 2 or atrophy associated is having P53 mutation, right? They will be having P53 mutation. So remember, overall, when we talk about the endometrial adenocarcinoma, P10 is more common than P53. So this point also we have to remember. That was the question in the NEET exam, right? When we are going to see the microscopic examination, they will resembling the endometrial adenocarcinoma, right? So they will be having gland and endometrial tissue, right? And they have good prognosis. So remember, hyperplasia, type 1, good prognosis. Type 2, mixed Müllerian appearance or serous or clear cell type, right? Serous or clear cell type, they will be having poor prognosis. So type 2, endometrial adenocarcinoma, atrophy associated will carry poor prognosis, right? Now, next we are going to discuss about the ovarian tumor. In this entire chapter, this ovarian tumor is the most important one, where you are going to get many questions. So first of all, we have to understand these are the most common adnexal mass in older individual more than 55 years of the age. Right? Risk factor in this patient will be the age, infertility, family history, mutation. Right? So age, infertility, family history, mutation. All these are the important things. Right? So increasing age, if the age is more, as you can see, they're having more risk, more infertility, more risk. Family history is present, then there is a more risk of the ovarian tumor and mutation. Which mutation, BRCA1, BRCA2, both are responsible for the ovarian tumor. Right? It's a very important MCQ which examiner asks. So which one is more important? So remember, BRCA1 is the most common mutation in the ovarian tumor. Right? What will decrease the risk of the ovarian tumor? So remember, OCP and breastfeeding will decrease the risk factor. Right? OCP and breastfeeding will decrease the risk factor of the ovarian tumor. Most common presentation, abdominal, see, most common presentation in this patient will be abdominal distension. Right? Because of the tumor mass, because of the tumor mass obstruction, or because of the ascites, because of the ascites created by the tumor cells. Malignant pleural effusion, maybe a component of the metastasis or component of the ovarian tumor. Malignant pleural effusion is not, the pleural effusion is not malignant. Malignant means recurrent, it will be coming again and again. You're treating and again it is coming, you're treating again it is coming. That is the meaning of malignant pleural effusion. That does not mean that is the malignant means malignancy. This malignant pleural effusion means they are having recurrent pleural effusion. I'll write it down here. Malignant means you are giving treatment but it is having recurrence. Right? So recurrent pleural effusion is also called as malignant pleural effusion. Right? Obstruction, because of the obstruction of the, you know, intestinal area or the cavities will be causing colicky pain. Right? And what are the tumor markers we are going to use for this ovarian tumor? CA125, which very famous, very often asked in exam, and what is not asked in exam but will be asked in exam is the osteopontin. So please remember, osteopontin is a tumor marker for ovarian tumor, one of the very specific marker. I should say one of the very specific marker for the ovarian tumor. Quite a specific marker for the ovarian tumor, right? So specific marker for the ovarian tumor is the osteopontin. So CA125, osteopontin, these are the tumor marker for the ovarian tumor, right? Now, WHO classification, what they say, that divide the ovarian tumor into four groups: surface epithelial tumor, germ cell tumor, sex cord stromal tumor, metastatic tumor. What we have read yesterday, the testicular tumor, germ cell, and sex cord. Now we are having two more things: surface epithelial and metastatic tumor. Right? Surface epithelial is the most common tumor. Right? So I understood. In testicular tumor, germ cell tumor were more common. But here in ovarian tumor, surface epithelial tumor are the most common. Surface epithelial tumor are the most common. And what are the surface epithelial tumor? Serous, mucinous, clear cell, endometrioid, benign tumor. So these are the four important surface epithelial tumor we have to remember. Right? Serous, mucinous, clear cell, benign. Endometrioid is not very important because this will be looking like endometrioid adenocarcinoma. That is why I said not very important. Nothing is here. But these four, serous, mucinous, clear, benign, these are important ones. Germ cell tumor, this seminoma is corresponding to the seminoma of the testis. Right? Pleocytic tumor, teratoma, choriocarcinoma. Yesterday we have read all these things. This seminoma is seminoma. We have read this also. Sex cord stromal tumor, granulosa cell tumor, Sertoli leading, both are together. Actually, I have just kept it separated. But it is Sertoli leading cell tumor, thecoma, fibroma, and metastatic tumor is Mullerian, extramullerian tumor. So we will discuss this tomorrow. Right? So let's start discussion of the ovarian tumor. What is the most common ovarian tumor? Just now I have told you, surface epithelial tumor is the most common, right? What is the overall most common tumor? Cyst adenocarcinoma is most common. Serous cyst adenocarcinoma. Remember, serous cyst adenocarcinoma is most common. So overall most common ovarian tumor is serous cyst adenocarcinoma, right? So please remember this one. Serous cyst adenocarcinoma is the overall most common ovarian tumor. Serous cyst adenocarcinoma is a part of surface epithelial tumor. So right? Don't worry about this thing. So you'll understand surface epithelial tumor. The serous tumor, they're serous benign borderline carcinoma. So this is the carcinoma. Right? So serous cyst adenocarcinoma is most common. Most common germ cell tumor. When examiner will be asking you what is the most common germ cell tumor of the ovary, germ cell, then your answer will be this chaperoma. Right? Most common sex cord stromal tumor. Most common sex cord stromal tumor is the granulosa cell tumor. Right? Now, serous tumor. Most common benign tumor, it is, right? The number one we are discussing about is surface epithelial tumor. Number one, surface epithelial tumor, I'm telling you. Right? So number one, surface epithelial tumor is serous tumor. This is the most common benign tumor. They will be bilateral. And gross examination, they will be having serous fluid within the cyst. So there will be a cyst which is containing serous fluid. Right? So what is serous tumor? It's most commonly benign tumor. Bilateral, gross finding, they will be having cyst with the serous fluid. Right? On microscopic examination, there are three types: benign, borderline, and malignant. Right? Overall, most common ovarian tumor, right? When examiner is asking, overall most common malignant tumor will be malignant tumor. Just we have just now discussed, right? Serous tumor, most common benign, should not be confused with the overall this one, right? So they are talking about the serous tumor, overall this benign tumor, right? But when we are talking about the most common ovarian tumor, this will be the malignancy is most common, right? Benign cyst adenoma, adenoma, borderline, malignancy. So there is nothing much difference. You have to understand 2-3 points, that's all, which examiner will be asking or which you should be knowing. Benign cyst adenoma, columnar epithelial, because these are columnar lining, columnar epithelial tumor cells will be there with no invasion. Koi invasion they will not be invading the underlying structure, so that is why it is benign. Columnar epithelial cells with no invasion is called as benign cyst adenoma, right? On microscopic examination, borderline, there will be mild ATPR but no stromal invasion. No stromal invasion, borderline. So benign and borderline, what is the difference? There is no stromal invasion, right? But in malignancy, you are going to see multi-layering of the columnar cell along with stromal invasion. Right? So that is the important thing. Stromal invasion is seen in malignancy, correct? Right? Now you can see this. This is the cystic area, ten cystic area. So these are the serous cyst adenoma of the ovary. Right? So these are the serous cyst adenoma of the ovary, and you can see these are the ten cyst containing the serous fluid. Right? So this is the serous cyst adenoma. Right? Serous cyst adenoma of the ovary. Now you can see these are all inflammation. Right? These are all inflammation, not the tumor. Don't think that these are the tumor. Right? What we can notice here? These are the ciliated columnar epithelium. Columnar epithelium, right? So this looks like a benign tumor, right? So they're not infiltrating into the underlying stroma. You can see that they're not coming here in the underlying stroma. They're just going like this, right? And nucleus is having stratification. Can you see that? Nucleus is having stratification, and there is a single layer of it, right? There is a single layer of the ciliated epithelium. If it would have been a tumor, there will be multiple layers. If it would have been a malignant, right? So it is a serous cyst adenoma, benign tumor, right? When we are going to see the serous cyst borderline tumor, so now you can see that the borderline tumor is having, tumor cells are a little bit weird, right? You can see they're having hyperchromatic nuclei, but none of them are infiltrating into the underlying stroma, right? They're not having any infiltration into the underlying stroma, so that is the borderline tumor, right? Here you can see, this is the stroma, and in the stroma you can see the gland. Can you see? In the stroma you can see the gland. So this is the invasive, so that is why it is carcinoma, serous carcinoma. Can you tell me, what are these structures? No. Basophilia is very high. This is not benign, this is carcinoma. serous sphagnum borderline carcinoma. These are the three variants you are going to see. And what are these things? These are the samoma bodies, calcification. No, not as a party effect like that, you can say that. But this is the, all these are the samoma bodies. All these are the dystrophic calcification showing you samoma body, laminated structures, right? So these are the samoma bodies. I think it is written here, samoma bodies, so right. Right, so these are the calcification, these are the calcification, these are the basophilic calcification, and they are called as samoma bodies in the serous sphagnocarcinoma. Right, mucinous second tumor, mucinous tumor is unilateral. Most commonly they are benign. Right, most commonly they are benign, and they are associated with the smoking and KRAS mutation. These are the important point you remember that mucinous tumor of the ovary is associated with the smoking. Right, so the female who smoke, they are prone for the mucinous tumor of the ovary. Right, and they are large multiloculated cysts filled with the gelatin-like sticky mucin. Right, so that is the important thing. Right, they are large multiloculated. They will be very large. Right, when examiner asks you which is the larger one, serous tumor or mucinous tumor, so remember mucinous tumor has been detected till the weight of 40 kg or something. Right, so they are very large. Mucinous will be larger, so large multiloculated, and they will be having gelatinous sticky mucin. Right, that will be the feature of mucinous tumor. Right, mucinous tumor is just like serous, benign, borderline, malignant. Three variants, right? These are the three variants, benign, borderline, malignant. Same thing, same story will be going on. Single layer of the colon epithelial cells with the mucin. Only thing, there was no mucin. If you look at the cell, can you see? None of them is showing any mucin. Look at this one. Can you see any of the cell is showing any mucin? Mucin is not present here. But in this case, there will be presence of mucin. That is why the name mucinous tumor. That is why the name is mucinous tumor. And here, in the benign, there will be no stromal invasion, no necrosis. Borderline, same thing. Atypical cells are there, but no stromal invasion, no necrosis. Malignant. Malignant tumor, they will be multi-layering, number one, and stromal invasion and necrosis will be there. So multi-layer columnar cells with stromal invasion and necrosis will be present in case of the mucinous tumor. So now you can see the mucinous tumor, what is the characteristic? Right, these are the important thing. They are characteristically associated with pseudomyxoma peritonei. Right, they are characteristically associated with pseudomyxoma peritonei. Atypical cell means that NC ratio will be high. That's anything. Chromatin will be hyperchromatin, NC ratio will be high, right? They may show the matrix figure also, right? So they are called as atypical cell. Why they are called as atypical? Because they are borderline. They are not very suggestive of the normal thing also, and they are not suggestive of the tumor also. They are atypical because of their appearance. They will be hyperchromatic nuclei, high NC ratio. They may have a matrix figure also, but it's difficult to see the matrix figure. But hyperchromasia and high NC ratio, you can appreciate that thing, right? So here you can see mucinous tumor is characteristically associated with pseudomyxoma peritonei. Very important thing. Pseudomyxoma peritonei is associated with which ovarian tumor? So it is associated with the mucinous tumor of the ovary. What is this? It is the peritoneal implants of the mucinous tumor. So that ovarian tumor will rupture, and the tumor cells which is containing mucin, they will be now adhere to the peritoneum. So this is called as peritoneal implants of the mucinous tumor. Yes, this is an example of direct spread. If you want to ask me, case of direct spread. So this is the example of direct spread. Right? This is the example of direct spread. Most commonly, they are associated with the mucinous tumor of the appendix. That is the important thing. You are seeing pseudomyxoma peritonei. Right? It's a general term where peritoneum is covered by the mucinous tumor cells. Right? Covered by the mucinous tumor cell. It can be ovarian mucinous tumor also. It can be the mucinous tumor of the appendix also. So pseudomyxoma peritonei, we are talking in terms of the mucinous tumor of the ovary. But if examiner asks you, they are most commonly associated with, then your answer should be the appendix mucinous tumor. So this point also we have to remember that. Pseudomyxoma peritonei is most commonly associated with the. So this statement is about pseudomyxoma peritonei. Please do remember this point. This statement is about the pseudomyxoma peritonei. Right? So pseudomyxoma peritonei is most commonly associated with the mucinous tumor of the appendix. Right? Now you can see this is the gross finding. Right? In this gross finding, you can see there are so many cysts. Right? There are so many cysts, multiloculated cysts. Right? Multiloculated cysts. And you can see the glistening gelatinous material is present in this cystic cavity. Right? So this is the mucinous cyst adenoma. Right? Now look at this mucinous cyst adenoma, benign tumor. Can you see? They are columnar cells. Can you notice? These are all columnar cell. And what is this? Can you notice the typical area of the columnar cells? They are showing you mucin, which was not there in the serous tumor. You remember, serous tumor, they were just simple columnar cells. But when you find the mucin, it means it is a mucinous cyst adenoma, right? Now next, now this one is the mucinous cyst adenocarcinoma. Can you see this? All the columnar cells are there, right? All these columnar cells are having multi-layering. Can you notice here? Especially this area, you can notice there is a multi-layering, right? So here I'm just showing you, what is this? This is the multi-layering of the nuclei. Multi-layering of the nuclei. Now you might be thinking that where is the mucin? Where is the mucin? Mucin is amphiphilic. Or in simple word, I should say that mixoid. Mixoid means they'll be eosinophilic also, they'll be basophilic also. Mixture of both things. Now you can see this is the mucin. This, can you see this? Purple or, you know, purplish mixoid appearance is the mucin. So this is the mucin we are seeing in the glands, right? So we can see there's some amount of mucin is here also. You can see some amount of mucin is here also, right? There is a mucin here also, right? So these are the mucinous tumor, right? So mucin producing columnar cells, right? So these columnar cells, you can see columnar cells, they are producing mucin. This is rich in mucin. This one is the best picture to observe the mucin, right? Now coming to the next one, the planar tumor of the ovary. So we have seen the serous tumor and mucinous tumor, right? Mucinous tumor is the largest one, and they will be bilateral. They will be having mucin, right? Serous tumor, they will be having samoma bodies. That is the important thing you have to remember, right? And overall, most common tumor is the serous only. Overall, most common malignancy is the serous malignancy, right? Planar tumor of the ovary. That is the, again, a surface epithelial tumor, right? What we are going to see in the planar tumor, they are benign tumor, unilateral, and they will be having Wolthard cell nests, right? Wolthard cell nests are the collection of the tumor cells resembling like a transitional epithelium of the urinary bladder. That is the very important thing which examiner ask you. Which ovarian tumor? Cells will be resembling like a transitional epithelium of the urinary bladder. So, planar tumor of the ovary. Tumor cells will be resembling transitional epithelium of the urinary bladder. Right? There will be having fibrous stroma consisting of the Wolthard cell nest, which will be containing all these transitional epithelial tumor. Right? And tumor cells will be also having coffee bean appearance. Coffee bean because of the nuclear grooming. That is also PGI question. Coffee bean appearance is seen in. Coffee bean appearance, you remember? Can you tell me? Just I'm making a list of that thing. Which we have read. I'm not going to make a very big list. Coffee bean nuclei. Where we have read this coffee bean nuclei? One is the Langerhans cell cystocytosis. Right? One we are reading now is the planar tumor. One more. No, not in the serous cyst adenoma. One is the granulosa cell tumor of the ovary, which we will be reading tomorrow. Granulosa cell tumor of ovary. So these are the three important tumors where we are going to see the coffee bean appearance, right? Fine. So now you can see this, there is a fibrous stroma. So you can see this is the spindly fibrous stroma. So that is what I was saying, fibrous stroma. And within this fibrous stroma, you can notice these are the tumor cell island. Right? So these are the tumor cell island. A tumor cell island. And how are these tumor cell island? When you are going to see on the high power view, they are looking like a transitional epithelial cells of the urinary bladder. And if you are going to see individual tumor cells, right, if you look at this individual tumor cell, so you can clearly see that there is a tumor cell and there is a nucleus, and you can see there is a grooving, right? Mantle cell lymphoma, nuclear grooming is there, but we cannot say that coffee bean appearance. We are not going to use that term. Usually coffee bean, we restrict it for the histopathological terminologies, right? So this is called nuclear grooving, which I marked here. They are showing you a nuclear grooving. Nuclear grooming, you can see in papillary carcinoma of the thyroid, right? So understood? So urinary bladder-like epithelial cell, urinary bladder-like epithelial cells embedded in the stroma is the Brenner tumor, right? So urinary bladder-like transitional epithelial cells are tumor cells are resembling like that. That means we are looking at the Brenner tumor, right? Brenner tumor of the ovary. Now, yesterday we have discussed so many things about this, right? Dysterminoma. As I have told you, dysterminoma is the counterpart of the seminoma. Right? Dysterminoma is the counterpart of the seminoma. Whatever seminoma we have learned, same thing you are going to see in the female. So it's the most common germ cell tumor of the ovary, right? Most common germ cell tumor of the ovary, right? Young patient age group is also same, 20 to 40 years. Endocrinologically, they are silent. So means there is no hormone produced by this tumor, right? So endocrinology is silent for this tumor. Gross is same, like I have told you that there is counterpart of the seminoma, encapsulated fleshy bulging size fibrous septa, right? Same as seminoma, microscopic examination, sheets, nests, right? Tumor cells, prominent nuclei, separated by fibrous septa, they may have lymphocytic infiltration, they may have granuloma also, right? So same as seminoma, that is why I have it. Tumor marker is also same as seminoma, LDH, placental alkaline phosphatase, OCT4, nanoG. So these are the molecular marker, you remember, molecular tumor marker, OCT4 and nanoG, right? So LDH, placental alkaline phosphatase, OCT4, nanoG will be present in the tumor marker of the dysgerminoma, right? And this is the picture of the dysgerminoma. You can see they are all same brownish, right? Brownish tumor mass separated by the fibrous septa. So this is the ovarian tumor dysgerminoma. It's a high power view, and you can see individual cells are large and hyperchromatic, right? The best picture you can see here, the same like yesterday's picture we have seen, right? Dysgerminoma, same picture you are going to see in the dysgerminoma. That is why it is called as counterpart, male counterpart of the seminoma, female counterpart of the seminoma, right? Yolk sac tumor, same thing. Infants and children, less than 3 year old, malignant tumor, most common germ cell tumor in less than 3 year old in female, malignant tumor, the tumor marker is AFP and alpha 1 antitrypsin, same thing, right? AFP and alpha 1 antitrypsin will be the tumor marker for the yolk sac tumor, right? Same appearance you are going to see here also, right? There is a central blood vessel surrounded by the tumor cell, enclosed inside a cystic cavity, and again enclosed inside a, again covered by tumor cells. So what is this? Schiller dual bodies or glomeruloid bodies, right? So Schiller dual bodies or glomeruloid bodies, so that's all, that is how you will remember. And now you can see the picture is like this, blood vessel, tumor cells, cystic space, again covered by tumor cells. So this is the Schiller dual bodies or glomeruloid bodies, right? And tumor markers are AFP and alpha 1 antitrypsin, Schiller dual bodies, right? Right, so I think these are the important things which I have covered very quickly. I think still 5 minutes are there, so let me tell you about the teratoma. Just I will give you introduction. Teratoma, entire thing I will be teaching you tomorrow because still some time is there. So here I would like to tell you about teratoma. We have read yesterday, but I just wanted to give you another important information. In teratoma tomorrow I will be telling you, already I told you that there is a mature, immature and monodermal or specialized teratoma, right? Monodermal or specialized teratoma. So I have told you that mature is mostly benign, right? Mature is most commonly benign, except, you remember, male, mature, malignant, right? So male, mature, malignant, that is the exception you have to remember. Immature is mostly malignant. Monodermal is only one, usually what is teratoma? Teratoma is all three germ cell or more than one germ cell layers are affected, right? So, but monodermal, only one germ layer differentiation will be present, right? So in monodermal, we are going to study two things, that is the stroma ovarii. Right, stroma ovarii, what is the most common component? That is the mature thyroid tissue. Most commonly, they will be showing you mature thyroid tissue. Right, so mature thyroid tissue is most commonly seen in stroma ovarii, right? Here, when we are talking about the benign tumor, right? Benign cystic teratoma. Benign cystic teratoma, if we see, they are also known as, can you tell me what is the another name of benign cystic teratoma? Dermoid cyst. So remember, dermoid cyst is a benign teratoma, right? When you are going to see the benign teratoma, they will be having a protrusion like this. Right, what is this protrusion called as? This protrusion is known as Rocky Tensky protrusion. Right, what is hidden under this Rocky Tensky protrusion? Teeth, hair, bone, cartilage. Right, so teeth, hair, bone, cartilage. All these things are together. Below this, you know, cyst, they are giving the appearance of the ridge or the protuberance, which is called as Rocky Tensky protuberance. Right, now the question is, what is clinical significance of this Rocky Tensky protuberance? Anybody, can you tell me? So when we are going to see this specimen, right, what I will suggest to my junior, that please take the section from here. Please take the section from the here, because they are having an increased risk of malignant transformation. Malignant transformation risk will be more. So this area which I'm showing you is having increased risk of the malignant transformation. So Rocky Tensky protuberance is not only simple MCQ. They have a high risk of the malignant transformation. That is why I wanted to see this benign cystic teratoma, right? They should not have a high malignant transformation. And which malignancy is most common? Which is the most common malignant transformation? So here you have to remember, most common transformation is of squamous cell carcinoma. Right, so squamous cell carcinoma is the most common transformation. So that is how examiner will be asking you a question. Right, how examiner will ask question earlier, that rocket ascii protuberance is seen in benign cystic keratoma. Now the future question is, what is the clinical significance of rocket ascii protuberance? Clinical significance of rocket ascii protuberance is the increasing risk for the malignant transformation. And which malignancy is most common? That is another important question. Squamous cell carcinoma is most common. Squamous cell carcinoma is most common malignant transformation into the benign cystic. See, it is a benign cystic keratoma. So why clinician is worried that they should not have a malignant transformation foci? So that is why clinician wanted to take out the section from here, and we are also eager to take the section from here so that we can rule out any kind of malignant transformation. And what transformation is most common? Squamous cell cancer is most common in the rocket ascii protuberance, right? So in keratoma, already I have told you yesterday that keratoma, what is the tumor marker? What is the tumor marker, right? So tumor marker for keratoma is, yes, always remember, alpha fetoprotein and beta HCG. Both are the tumor marker for the keratoma. Both are the tumor marker. So AFP and beta HCG, both of the above, that was the question. Both of the above are tumor marker for keratoma, right? So tomorrow we'll be discussing about the rest of the, ovarian tumor plus gestational trophoblastic tumor, I'll be studying, discussing, and then we'll be starting the CA breast, right? So we'll be covering all those things tomorrow. Quiz.